Discoveries about motion, but I also want to be able to give you a mathematical description of what's going on. So that will then help you be more quantitative about. He knew that if you drop an object, right, that the further the object falls, and I showed you this experiment, the further it falls, you know, the faster it goes. He kind of knew that, but he wanted to figure out, you know, how exactly would, how much faster does it go as it travels for longer and longer time? And so this new idea that he had was to, instead of looking at how fast it goes depending on how much it travels, he started to think about how fast it goes depending on how much time has passed. So start looking at the motion as a function of time. And that's what we're going to do now, is to look at the motion as a function of time. Just as he did with the pendulum and the pulse, okay? He found out the motion of the pendulum and timed it with the pulse, okay? So we already said that the falling body goes faster and faster as time progresses, but he wanted to know what is the precise law for the falling body going faster with time. The distance fallen increases with time, how much? And I'm going to do that now with this demonstration called the Sonic Ranger. I have this, so I have this different computer here, which is going to present to you the graph of its motion, and I'm going to plot the graph of these motions as it happens. So normally what you do is you make measurements, and you make a table, and then you get some graph paper, and you graph it, okay? Whereas this system has a speed, you know, the guy who's the policeman who's sitting there with this Doppler radar or whatever, and he's catching your speed as you, if you, I have one of those things here, all right? That's what you call a sonic radar. So it's basically sending sound waves back and forth and measuring how long the sound waves take to come back and forth. And by that method, it's going to actually figure out where is this ball in distance, okay? So we're going to plot its position as a function of time that passed. And by time, I mean the real time, okay? Because now you know that this ball is falling very fast, yeah? I mean, I hardly have 1 second to do my experiment, right? So it's going to be really rough if I try to use my pulse or a stopwatch or something. But with this Sonic Ranger, he can actually measure the velocity of the ball and the position of the ball, okay, as a function of time, and plot it for you, right? So I'll do this a couple of times, so you can see that as the ball falls, the computer and the Sonic Ranger are going to capture the information and display it for you. All right. So hopefully all this works out good. So I'm going to drop from this height, okay, all the way down, and we're going to start. Okay, so we only need to look at the first part of the fall. Okay, if you all watched carefully, the ball fell and hit the ground here. Okay, so ignore the rest of this stuff because it's complicated, right? Because once it hits the ground, it turns around and goes upwards, right? Let's ignore that. We just want to ask how fast does the ball fall with time? How much distance does it travel with time? Which means you only look at the part of the motion when I dropped it, and I dropped it right there because I started the computer's data, the Sonic Ranger, and I let the Sonic Ranger do nothing for a while. And you'll notice that, let's look at the speed of the ball first. Okay? So you'll notice that the speed of the ball as a function of time, and notice that it only took half a second to fall, that the speed of the ball as a function of time is increasing linearly with time. Okay, so the speed gets faster and faster and faster. So had I dropped it from the top of the ceiling here, of course, it would have taken 3 seconds or 2 seconds to fall. And during that entire time, this guy would have kept going like this, right? Unless it reached its terminal velocity, in which case it would go like this and saturate out. But I didn't allow it to reach its terminal velocity. This guy is telling me that the velocity goes to zero because it stopped at the ground, right? And then the velocity became negative because it turned around and went up, okay? But ignore all that. When I dropped it, the velocity increases linearly with time. This is the law, okay? This is the law that Galileo figured out without a sonic ranger, without graph paper, without all the modern instruments, and he was able to time things much better than in a much cleverer way than I'm doing. Okay, now look at this other part. Again, ignore all this other stuff. And here you have the distance or the position of the ball as a function of time. And you'll notice that the distance is not just increasing linearly. There's a curve to it. Okay? And that curve is actually, if I were to give you the mathematical expression, the distance traveled goes like t squared. D, because here's a parabola. Right? D goes like t squared. That's a parabola. And that also Galileo figured out. And I'm going to show you how he figured that out. So here's the challenge. Okay, this is muted now, so let me not. So Galileo had two challenges. One is the motion is too fast, and you need a good time measurement device. So what he did was he slowed down the motion. First thing he did was he said, instead of dropping an object straight down, let me drop it on a ski slope, right? So it's still dropping due to gravity, it's still going to the bottom, but now I've slowed down the motion so I can measure it. And then he developed a new method of timing it. Again, it wasn't his pulse, he actually used what is called a water clock, and he measured drips of water, okay? And as the water dripped, he timed the motion. Now, again, I'm not going to do all that. I'm going to use my good old sonic ranger again, okay? And I'm going to use this cart. And by the way, I'll be using this cart many, many times. And the cart's going to go down this incline. And I'm going to plot the same quantities. The velocity is a function of time, and the distance traveled goes like time squared. I'm going to plot that with this sonic ranger here. So I got a blank sheet of graph paper. I'm going to do the same thing, position versus time and velocity versus time. And now I'm going to use, instead of a basketball falling straight down, I'm going to have this cart go straight down. And hopefully it's not going to fall and break and so on, okay? All right, so here we go. Start it. Okay, so let's discuss what we obtained, right? So again, I did not let it go until about this time, right? And then I let it go. And you'll notice the velocity increases linearly with time, just like the basketball, okay? Except much less. So why is the velocity increasing much less? Remember that velocity of the basketball went like very fast. Why is this velocity much less? I changed the incline, right? The other incline was like this, right? Now it's going like this. Friction plays a role, it's true, but not the dominant role, okay? So this velocity is increasing linearly with time, just like before, and the distance traveled, you can see very clearly, is a parabola. Ignore all this part, because here where the cart hit the end, okay? So the distance traveled goes like time squared, and the velocity increases linearly with time. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to try to approach this situation here by increasing this incline. Okay? So I'm going to take another 2x4 here and make this incline steeper, right? And I'm going to start with the cart. And now it's probably going to fall off. Okay, I got to make sure that the tracks are in the rails. Sorry, the wheels are in the rails. And now we're going to start the timing. Oh, it erased the other guy. It erased the other guy. But anyway, I should have stored it. I can do it again. But you probably remember what the other graphs looked like, right? Now, this velocity is more as a function of time. Let me actually store this and do the narrow one again. The shallow one again. Okay, do the shallow one again. So now it'll save this data and make the incline shallow. All right, so now here you have both the graphs there, one with the lower incline, one with the fast higher incline. And you notice that this one approaches its distance, it's traveled much more distance in the same time because it's going at a higher velocity in the same time, and this lower incline had a lower velocity. However, here now is the important part, okay, that the law of how the velocity changes with time and how the distance changes with time is the same no matter how the incline is. If the incline is shallow or the incline is steep, it's the same law. Okay? It's the same law. And this is the law that Galileo derived. And then now, as I said, Galileo does observations and measurements and precision, and then comes his leap of thought. Okay? And his leap of thought was the following, that if I took this incline and went all the way up to 90 degrees and repeated the experiment, okay, I would get the same behavior, okay, namely that the velocity would increase linearly with time, but much faster, and the distance traveled would go like time squared in a parabola, but again, much more distance for the same amount of time, or just by extrapolation of the incline of the plane. Right, so those were Galileo's discoveries. I'm going to show you a little bit more now, detail, how he came to those laws, because he didn't have all these devices that I have the advantage of. So what he did was he had this inclined plane, okay? And he could have a shallow incline or a steep incline. And he had his little clock timer. And he measured with a ruler or with a friend what is the distance that the object travels for the same intervals of time that pass. So if you have 1 second, 2 seconds, 3 seconds pass, he measured these distances. The ruler. So let's suppose that after 1 second, the distance that the ball traveled was 1 inch. And let's suppose that after 2 seconds, it traveled a different distance. And after 3 seconds, it traveled a different distance. And here's something amazing that Galileo discovered with his observations, is that these distance intervals are all connected to the first distance interval by the odd numbers. Okay? In other words, if this was 1 inch, then in the second, it would travel 3 inches. And the third, it would travel 5 inches. Okay? So by measuring that, then of course, if you made it steeper, this instead of being 1 inch, it would be, let's say, 2 inches. But in that case, if this were 2 inches, this would be 6 inches, and this would be 10 inches. Still three times and five times the number first. That's why I call it B. Then this is 3B and this is 5B. And if that was A, this is 3A and this is 5A. And if it kept going, it'll be 7, 9, 11, the odd numbers. Okay, the distance interval that are traveled are the odd numbers. So that was the key to Galileo's discovery of the law behind it. So these were the two clever ideas that I talked about. And now he introduced these ideas which you've already seen. One is average speed, which is basically distance travel over time elapsed. And you're very familiar with that concept because, you know, say I'm going 50 miles per hour. Distance travel, this 50 miles over time elapse in 1 hour, 50 miles per hour. So you know what speed is. And he introduced this new idea of acceleration. Acceleration is change in speed over time, right? And when they sell the cars, they say, you know, it goes from 0 to 60 in so many seconds, 30 seconds or whatever. Well, that means it has so much acceleration. What is acceleration? Well, the definition of acceleration is the change of speed over the change of time. And we'll do that much more deeply now as we look at the tables. Okay. So now let's look at this simple picture that I had, and let's analyze it carefully, as did Galileo. Okay. So there it is. First interval is A, 3A. Next interval is 3A. Then third interval is 5A. And the timing for arriving here and here and here is 1 second, 2 seconds, and 3 seconds. And so I can make a table that the distance interval is 1 inch, let's say, 3 inches, and 5 inches. Now that means I can write down immediately what is the total distance traveled as a function of time. So all I do is I add them up, right? So the first interval of time, I got 1. And the second interval of time, I have to add these 2 up. So I get 4. And in the third interval of time, I have to add all these 3 up, right? So that's 5 and 3, 8 and 1, 9. And as you know from Pythagoras, if you add up odd numbers, you get n squared. And so that's why it goes 1, 4, 9, 16. So there he got his first law already, that parabola that I showed you. D, the distance traveled, goes like time squared. That's your parabola. And that's how he figured it out. Right? Now, the next part was a bit harder. Namely, what is the speed here? What's the speed here? What's the speed here? Problem is, the speed is always changing. Right? Every tiny bit of a time, the speed is different. Because the speed is constantly increasing with time. So how do you say what is the speed? So what you do is you say, you define a particular moment in time at which you're going to give the speed. And the moment in time that I've chosen and that Galileo chose was the average time between here and here. So let's say half a second later. And the average time between here and here, so 1.5 seconds later, and the average time here and here, 2.5 seconds later. So now he says, I want to calculate what is the speed when the ball arrives at these positions. Okay? So the speed that when the ball arrives at time t mid, okay, is 1, because it travels 1 in 1 second, so the speed is 1 inch per second. Here it travels 3 in 1 second, so the speed is 3 inches per second from here to here. And here it travels 5, so the speed is 5 inches per second. So at these points, the speed is 1, 3, and 5 inches per second. And now he notices that these velocities, 1, 3, and 5, are really just double the time that he named. Okay, the time that he named is 0.5 second, 1.5 seconds, 2.5 seconds. And these numbers are 1, 3, and 5. And so here comes his law. Velocity is proportional to time. Velocity is 2t. V equals 2t. So the two laws, the velocity is proportional to time, and the distance goes as time squared. You can get out directly from this nice table of just the odd numbers that you get when you measure the distances traveled. Now he goes to this more advanced concept of acceleration. And as I said, acceleration means how much does the velocity change with the time passed. Okay? So again, you just look at the table and you ask, maybe the acceleration is changing with time, maybe it's not changing with time, we don't know at this stage. We just say, let's calculate the acceleration when it's here, let's calculate the acceleration when it's here, let's calculate the acceleration when it's here, which means after we've written down the time moments, 0.5 second, 1.5 seconds, 2.5 seconds, and we've got the velocity, v equals 2t, 1 inch per second, 3 inch per second, 5 inches per second. Now let's calculate the change in the velocity and divide it by the time. So the change in the velocity from here to here is 3 minus 1, it's 2 in 1 second. So it's 2 inches per second here. The change in velocity from here to here is 5 minus 3, which is 2 inches per second. So you see the acceleration did not change. Big discovery. Acceleration, which is the change in velocity over time, is a constant. So for this kind of fall, the acceleration is a constant. If you make the incline steeper, the acceleration is a constant. If you make the incline even steeper and make it vertical fall, like this one, then acceleration is a constant. And now he had all the laws that he needed. Okay, namely, the laws of motion have the same time dependence. Acceleration is a constant. The velocity is proportional to time. Sorry about that. And the total distance traveled increases as time squared, even when the angle becomes 90 degrees, which is your vertical free fall. All the laws are the same. And this is the generalization.